Madam, we are live.
Can we start?
Yes.
Okay, good morning everyone. On behalf of MCIA and TNIA, we welcome you all, the judges, the moderators, the presenters, the coordinators, and the technical backup team for this day. We start up with the first session of the free paper presentation on comprehensive ophthalmology. Here we have 8 papers. The moderators for the session, the bold and the beautiful, Dr. Sharmila and Dr. Divya. Dr. Sharmila Devi Vinod is the current editor, Journal of TNIA and Associate Professor of Ophthalmology, Cornea Services at RIO Egmore. And Dr. Divya Karthik is a senior consultant, Cornea Department, Aravind Eye Hospital, Chennai. So I request the moderators to introduce the judges and start the free paper presentation.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the first session of the day. Thank you, Dr. Manoj, for the kind words of introduction. I'm still a senior assistant professor only. I still haven't got my promotion. And we have 8 to 9 presenters today. And I request the presenters to stick to your time. Please, there'll be a buzzer or a reminder for you from Mr. Sai Numerotech at the end of 3 minutes. So again, after that buzzer, you'll have 1 more minute to present. So please stick to your time. After 4 minutes, your screen sharing will be stopped. And after that 4 minutes, you'll have 1 minute of question and answer session. So let's have a great session. Please stick to your time. We have two very esteemed judges for this session, Professor Vasanta ma'am and Sujata Mohan ma'am. They are experts in cornea, the specialty of cornea. Some of them have opted for presenting in the 2022 session. So we have combined a couple of specialties together. So we have cornea refractive surgery, cataract, and comprehensive ophthalmology together in this session. It's my honor to introduce Professor Vasanta ma'am. She's the retired director and superintendent of Government Ophthalmic Hospital, also the past president of Tamil Nadu Ophthalmic Association. She's an academician to the core. Every day she reads the journal. So you can expect a lot of questions. She's totally updated, and she's the teacher of all teachers. I now request Dr. Divya Karthik to introduce Sujata ma'am.
Good morning, all. I take great pleasure in introducing Dr. Sujata madam, who is the associate medical director of Rajan Eye Care and who's also an eminent cornea and refractive surgeon. And she has won the prestigious Nari Shakti Purushkar Award recently. She has a lot of publications to her credit and is a great teacher, as most of us here know her. So without much ado, I think we'll move on to Jin, and all the very best to all the participants. Dr. Sharmila already mentioned, I would like to re-emphasize that we need to stick on to the timings, and timings also has marks. So please stick on to the timings, participants, and all the very best. So the first free paper number 3. Judges, kindly note, it is free paper number 3 by Dr. Juhi Cherian.
Thank you, ma'am. Shall I share the screen, ma'am?
Yes, please.
Yes, you can.
Ma'am, is it visible?
Yes.
Yes, it's visible. Okay. Go on.
Yes, Juhi.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Juhi Cherian, senior resident at Pondicherry Institute of Medical Science. My topic is emetropization after phacoemulsification, a prospective cohort study. One of the most important factors determining final refractive outcome after cataract surgery is a selection of appropriate IOL power formulae. So among the various available IOL power formulae, the most predictable one is yet to be determined. To compare the predictability of six, our aim of the study was to compare the predictability of 6 different IOL power calculation formulae in determining the postoperative refraction following phacoemulsification with short, normal, and long axial length. My inclusion criteria included age-related cataract who underwent phacoemulsification surgery with in-the-bag IOL placement, who achieved a postoperative BCVA of 0.3 or more, and those patients who had any anterior segment or posterior segment pathologies, who had high squint, high corneal astigmatism, and intra and postoperative complications were eliminated from the study. Moving on to methodology in detail, there were 324 eyes included. Preoperative assessment was done for all patients. Keratometry was done using automated keratometer. A-scan was used for measuring the axial length, and the IOL power calculation was done using ultrasound biometry, EchoRule Pro, and patients were divided into three groups depending on the axial length. Axial length less than 22 millimeter was considered as a short group, and more than 24.5 mm was considered as the long axial length group. IOL power calculation formulae used were these six formulae, and the target in IOL power calculation was a lens power that would yield a post-op refraction nearest to plano, erring on the side of myopia. All patients underwent phacoemulsification. It was uneventful. An actual post-op spherical equivalent was calculated at the end of 1 month. So the predictive accuracy of each formulae was analyzed by comparing the difference between the actual corrected spherical equivalent and predicted post-op spherical equivalent preoperatively. So again, the methodology, 324 eyes, 108 eyes in each group, and each group, six formulae were included, 18 patients in each formulae, and each patient estimation error was calculated, which is the difference between the actual and the predicted spherical equivalent, and a mean absolute estimation error was calculated for each formula, and all the mean absolute estimation error were compared between the formulae in each group. And this comparison was done using Kruskal Wallis edge test. So moving on to the results, this is a box and whisker plot. So the width of the plot shows us the interquartile range, and the line within the box shows us the median. So in this, as we see, the smaller the box, the variability is less and predictability is more. So the Hages and Hofer-Q formulae had statistically significant lower median.
Excuse me, doctor, 1 minute more.
In comparison to SRK2, Binghorst and SRKT formulae. And in normal axial length group, SRK2 compared to Binghorst had more had lower median error. And in long axial length group, Holliday when compared to SRK2, T and Binghorst, and Hofer-Q and Hages when compared to Binghorst had lower median absolute error. So to conclude, short axial length group, my study showed that Hages and Hofer-Q is better. In normal, SRK2 is better. And in long axial length group, Holliday is better. Thank you.
I request the judges to question if there are any question answers for the questions for the.
Just wanted to one question, Dr. Juhi. I just want to know, you didn't consider using the Barrett's IOL calculator, because that is the one which is now used by most of us. You didn't consider that?
Yes, ma'am. So, but we were usually using this as a procedure, so we want to know. In our setup, what was accurate from what we are using?
What is the commonest IOL calculator formula that you use in your setup?
So, ma'am, we usually use SRK2.
Okay, SRK2. So, according to you, Holliday and Hofer-Q are the best for almost all the powers, except
yes,
except I think in hyperopia. Hyperopia also they are good, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah,
in hyperopia also.
Were you using the same lens?
Sorry, ma'am?
Were you using the same lens for all cases, Emma? Same brand?
Yes, ma'am. Same lens was used for all the patients.
Because sometimes I find when you change the lenses, it's not all that accurate, some lenses.
No, ma'am. We use the same lens for all patients.
Okay,
that's a
good study.
Thank you. Okay, so we move on to the next presentation. I request Dr. Arjun to present this paper on refractive surgery.
Yes, sir. So I'll share my screen now. Good morning to everyone. My topic of discussion is comparison of outcomes of topographic guided LASIK, that is contour revision, and wavefront optimized LASIK ablation in myopic astigmatism. Introduction about the LASIK. It is an refractive surgery where it is an interstomal procedure using excimer laser photo ablation. In our study, we had compared two types of ablation, that is the topo guided LASIK, that is contour revision, and the wavefront optimized LASIK ablation. What is ref and optimized ablation? It actually minimizes the induced spherical aberration by placing additional laser pulses in the periphery, and is based only on the refractive prescription. Whereas in contrast ablation, it actually combines both the refractive prescription as well as the corneal topographical map. We need to compare the outcomes of topographic guided LASIK contour ablation and wafer optimized LASIK and myopic astigmatism in contralateral eyes. So parameters of comparison were visual acuity, any gains or loss of lines, and contrast sensitivity. So Mittelson methodology, it is a prospective interventional study of contralateral eyes, which included 63 patients. And contour group 34 right eye and 29 left eye, and we have an optimized at 29 right eyes and 34 left eyes. And the degrees of myopia were also distinguished as high, moderate, and low, with 10 high and 4-6 moderate and 7 low in case of topography guided LASIK, and WFN optimized LASIK at 47 moderate and 8 low and 8 high. And in case of spherical value, it is -4.29 and -4.36 in WFN optimized group and topography guided LASIK group respectively, and -1.46 and -1.62 of astigmatism in both groups respectively. Pre-LASIK evaluation included the visual acuity, topography, pentacam, topolaser, and pachymetry, which was actually transferred to the pre-laser working station through a network called as the WaveNet, where we actually plan for the profile for each patient. This is a simple example of the same eye, just showing the profile of the wafer ablation and contour ablation. Here in wafer optimized, it actually takes up only the central corneal thickness, whereas in case of contour vision, it actually takes all quadrants of the tip pachymetry, that is superior temporal, nasal inferior, and as well as the central pachymetry. So here's the ablation profile, where you see here in case of contour, it is more precise and it's more of a fingerprint like topography. So in our results, we had found that in all postoperative visits, topographic guided LASIK, that is contour vision, had better visual acuity than the wafer optimized. And in case of contrast sensitivity, the initial post-op day 1 and 1 week, we had more or less similar results in the contrast sensitivity between the both groups. But in case of post-op 1 month and 6 months, we had seen improved contrast sensitivity results in case of topography, that is contour vision group. And
excuse me, doctor.
Yes, ma'am.
1 minute more.
Okay. And in case of gains of lines, in all post-operative results, we had seen more number of lines, gains of lines in case of topo-gated group. And in all grades of myopia, topo-gated was seen better. So in our study, both groups showed excellent refractive efficacy and perfectability. Contour vision had increase in gain of lines, and it showed significantly better contrast sensitive results as well. And there were similar studies which actually showed similar results in our study as well. So contrast vision is actually like more of a fingerprint like individualized customized treatment profile, in where the topolaser measures its submicroscopic kick and value of the cornea to a hyper precise degree, and wafer optimized it actually incorporates non-custom peripheral laser ablation to the corneal edges to prevent its induced aberration and gives an improved optical quality. Thank you.
Ma'am, you have to ask the question, ma'am. This is part of my paper, so.
No, but you are an expert in this. So you only have to ask. Have you tried it for plain astigmatism? Always compound myopic astigmatism.
Let him talk. Yeah, you answer.
In our study, we had actually taken only myopic astigmatism, ma'am. Okay. We didn't include any plain, like, we didn't include myope alone, we had combined only myopic estimate.
That is simple myopic estimate.
Compound myopic estimate.
Okay. That is what I wanted to do. So anyway, newer techniques are better.
Sorry, ma'am?
Anyway, newer techniques are coming up only for improving the results, no?
Yes.
So I don't find anything. It's already proved. Okay, I have no more questions.
Arjun, I have a question. What were the powers, the maximum astigmatism that you have corrected?
Ma'am,
was there any difference between
ma'am, the actual range was from minus 0.25 to minus 2, ma'am. Astigmatism went up to minus 2, that is all. We didn't take any higher astigmatism value.
Dr. Sharmila, any questions from your side?
No, we can move on if there are no questions.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Arjun. And
thank you,
I would like the judges to note, Arjun's free paper number was 32.
30. Arjun's paper was
30. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
And the next presenter will be free paper number 32, Dr. Pavitra. Dr. Pavitra?
Ma'am, she needs to stop sharing for me to share, ma'am.
Stop sharing.
Okay. Arjun, can you please stop sharing your screen?
Yes, sorry.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes, you're audible. Please.
My slides visible, ma'am?
Yeah. Yes, your slides are visible, doctor. Please go on. Yes, your voice is very clear.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. A warm good morning to everyone. My topic for today's presentation would be the impact of digital resource training on the quality of life of visually impaired patients. Myself, Dr. Pavitra, I'm a final year postgraduate. I would like to start by thanking my co-guide, Dr. Sahitya, for giving me this opportunity. This would be the synopsis for today's presentation. And coming to visual impairment in India, it is estimated to around 62 million people, of which 54 million have low vision and 8 million suffer from blindness or profound VI. So these are the obstacles as a developing country we face. Main is access to rehabilitation, the affordability of the patient, the social stigma, and the timely early referral. The aim of our study was to evaluate the impact of special software training in improving the quality of life in persons with visual impairment. It was a cross-sectional study which included 50 persons over the age of 15 years who had both congenital or either acquired visual impairment according to the WHO criteria. And persons with multiple disabilities were excluded from the study. The digital resource training was given basically with NVDA software. This non-visual desktop access software, which is developed in 2006, had the following features, like it is freely downloadable and accessible in all digital applications and available at 50 languages. Other similar softwares are JAWS and ORCA. This software converts the input as text, which we are giving, to a speech output so that the patients who are coming are able to listen to the text and learn. Apart from that, there were accessibility options with apps regarding orientation, mobility, and money identifier app were also taught to them. It was given over a period of 10 days for 6 hours per day with total of 60 hours of training. And then the low vision quality of life questionnaire was administered in the form of oral interview before and after 6 months of training. It mainly concentrated on vision related quality of life questions in the following domains. These were the results which shows that the quality of life scores before and after training showed a significant improvement in all domains except activities of daily living, which can be attributed because this was more of a technological skill and not to self-care or activities of daily living. And coming from the data we analyzed, 10 people who had been unemployed before had begun employment after this training, which had included 2 retired persons and 4 women, which shows that the training had helped them become socially and economically independent also. Coming to the conclusion, the study population majorly in our study group were less than 30 years of age, which is a socially and financially active group. So this early rehabilitation can actually reduce their economic burden of the family. And the majority of persons included male, with only 36% of female, which shows that there is inaccessibility of women to rehabilitation, but also to education as such in the presence of VI. And almost 93% of them were in mainstream education. So either there is a loss of access to the special education or any associated social stigma which have. It can be decreased by giving more integrative education and designing more computer programs also. And the limitations of the study was it had a small sample size and a short follow-up, and we need to explore more on other types of similar software also. These are the references, and I would like to conclude by saying one of our chief quotes, that intelligence and capability are not enough. There must be a joy of doing something beautiful. So let's start by creating a beautiful world for these people to achieve and increase their quality of life. Thank you, ma'am.
Excellent, Pavitra. Very nice. But you have to tell me from which institute you're coming from.
I'm doing my final year post-graduation in Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai, ma'am.
Yeah, you've not mentioned that in your slide, but I just assume it must be Arvind. Anyway, it's a very good presentation. And I just want to know, is it available for other people, or do you have these?
Hello?
Do you have
Hello,
these?
Ma'am?
Hello, are you able to hear me?
Hello?
Yes?
We are able to hear you.
Yeah.
Hello?
She's
ma'am?
Having a problem. Pavitra is having a problem with the net issues.
Ma'am? Yes, ma'am. I'm able to hear, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes.
See, I just want to know whether this is available commercially, or you conduct these workshops now and then. And what is the... this is the just first...
No, ma'am. It is available for everyone, ma'am. It's not conducted as a workshop. This now we had whoever patients are coming with low vision... we are giving them as per their needs, ma'am. It's not a continuous 10-day also. Some people want to do it 5 days and then come back after 1 month and then do their 5 days also, ma'am. So it's available like that.
And is it charged or it's free?
Yes, ma'am. For it's 1,000 rupees now for 60 hours of training. But even in this study, some people who are not able to afford, we had done it using the help of low vision aids grant, which we are having, ma'am.
Thank you. It's a wonderful person.
How educated were they? Should they have computer knowledge and all that?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, we included patients who had a basic of quality of like 8th standard, at least 8th grade of education with basic English proficiency, ma'am. So, we're actually, for training them, it was easy, ma'am.
Okay.
This is
a good attempt, doctor.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
We can go on to the next paper.
Next paper, we have FP100, Dr. Divya Sunil. Dr. Divya Sunil there.
Yes, ma'am. Shall I start now?
Yeah. Please introduce yourself while
Yes.
Present.
Your free paper number also has to be mentioned.
Yes. Free paper 100, ma'am. Free paper 100, Dr. Divya Sunil.
Second one. Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Divya from Joseph Eye Hospital. I'll be presenting on the analysis of peripapillary retinal nerve fiber layer thickness in diabetics. The most common ocular complication of diabetes is diabetic retinopathy. Diabetic retinopathy is the leading cause of blindness in most developed countries and in working age adults. Diabetic retinopathy is considered to be a microvascular disorder, but recent studies show that retinal neurodegeneration is present even before the development of clinically detectable microvascular damage. The peripapillary RNFL thinning has been observed in the retina of diabetic patients. These damages could be due to the metabolic alterations, production of advanced glycation end products, oxidative stress, hemodynamic changes. The aim of our study is to evaluate the peripapillary RNFL thickness in diabetics using spectral domain OCT. Observational case study was done at Joseph Eye Hospital from October 2019 to February 2020. 120 eyes of 60 diabetic patients were studied. This is the inclusion criteria. We excluded patients with a spherical error of more than 5, cylindrical power of more than 3, IOP of more than 21, any glaucomatous optic disc changes, neuro-ophthalmic diseases, any previous history of retinal laser photocoagulation was also excluded. All the patients underwent a best-corrected visual acuity, intraocular pressure, slit lamp examination of both the anterior and posterior segments. OCT pictures were taken using the optic disc cube 200x200 protocol. The mean values of peripapillary RNFL thickness in all the four quadrants and the average RNFL thickness was obtained. Statistical analysis was done using the Studentese test, and a p-value of less than 0.05 was significant. We divided the patients into two groups. Group 1 consisted of patients with diabetic retinopathy. We included both PDR and NPDR patients. None of the PDR patients had NVD or any prior retinal photocoagulation. Group 2 patients consisted of diabetic patients with no retinopathy. Comparing the mean age between groups 1 and 2, we could see that there was no statistical significance indicating that they were age matched. We could see a could see a female male preponderance in both the study groups. On comparing the difference in mean RFN thickness in groups 1 and 2 in the superior nasal, inferior temporal and throughout the 360 degree, we could find no statistical significance between the two groups. On comparing the difference between the PDR groups and NPDR groups also, we could find no significant difference between the two groups. This is the OCT picture of a patient in group 1 who was a diabetic for 10 years. This OCT picture shows no thinning in his RNFL. This is the OCT picture in group 2 who has been diabetic for 5 years, similarly showing no thinning in RNFL. The study of RNFL is important as it can detect the early loss of retinal ganglion cells. As the neuronal loss is irreversible, it is important to screen in the early stage of diabetic retinopathy and prevent further deterioration. In the current study, there was no statistically significant difference between the RNFL thickness between
one group minute one more.
Okay, thank you. Between the two groups with a p-value of 0.09. A study by Cognister et al. Found that the size and shape of the optic disc, NRR, and the parapapillary atrophy did not differ significantly between diabetic and the normalized. Toprak et al. Found that the mean RNFL thickness was significantly lower in diabetic patients, unlike our study. And Kao et al. Also found a significant thinning in the superior nasal and inferior nasal quadrants, unlike our study. The limitation of the study was that we had a very small sample size and no comparison was made with the values in the non-diabetic patients. To conclude, in the study, the results suggest that peripapillary RNFL thickness is not significantly altered by the presence of retinopathy in patients with diabetes. Thank you.
Actually given, because it's only 4 minutes now since she started.
Sorry, ma'am?
Since you started, it's only 4 minutes because I timed it thinking okay. That you people are given very short time. Okay. Now, in most of the studies I have gone through, they have demonstrated only thinning.
Yes, ma'am.
But in your study, there was absolutely no difference.
Yes, ma'am. We could not pick up maybe because of a smaller sample size.
The other thing, you know, have you age matched these patients? Or
yes.
Have you looked at the refractive error of these patients? And you have looked at the glaucoma status of these patients? All these three things have been taken into account?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So myopics, you know, there is some amount of retinal thinning anyway that takes place.
Yes, ma'am.
So you have matched this diabetic and non-diabetic group based on the refractive error also?
No, ma'am. We excluded all the patients with the myopic error of more than 5. Okay. We didn't include those patients.
What about the glycemic control of the patients? Because most of the papers say that it's reduced, right?
Yes, ma'am.
This is in relation to the glycemic status as well.
We didn't take that factor into account, ma'am. All the patients were on control when they were on medical management.
So you mean to say this evaluation of the peripapillary nerve thickness is of no use in predicting the incidence of diabetic retinopathy?
Maybe if we had taken a larger sample size, we could have picked up, I feel, ma'am, but...
Okay, doctor, negative results are also important. I'm not saying all cases you must get only positive results. That is okay. But we should come to at least some conclusion, no? Either negative or positive.
I think because of the sample size was too small, I think it doesn't match with the other
studies.
Yes. It's okay. I mean, whatever you got, you have to present.
Okay, that way actually we appreciate that. Whatever you got, you present it.
Thank you.
Okay. Sharmila, if there's no other questions, we'll go on to this.
Next speaker will be free paper 174. Dr. Loya Geeta Anusha.
Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Geeta, please start your video.
Yes, ma'am. One second, ma'am.
Can you go to the first slide?
Yes, ma'am. Are my slides visible, ma'am?
Yes, your first slide is visible.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Comparison of safety and efficacy of prednisolone acetate, difluprednate, and loteprednol eye drops post cataract surgery. Aim of the study is to compare safety and efficacy of anti-inflammatory activity of 1% prednisolone acetate eye drops versus 0.05% difluprednate eye drops versus 0.5% loteprednate etoposide eye drops following uncomplicated cataract surgery. Introduction. Due to the invasive nature of modern cataract surgery, infection and intraocular inflammation are the two common outcomes, out of which infection following cataract surgery remains a great concern. On the other hand, inflammation after cataract surgery, which can be persistent, remains an undesirable consequence. Most ophthalmic surgeons use a standard prophylactic regimen to prevent infections and reduce postoperative inflammation and pain, and typically consist of a corticosteroid or NSAID. This study will discuss in detail the use of corticosteroids in management of ocular inflammation following cataract surgery. Materials and methods. This is a randomized interventional double-blinded study where we analyzed whether the less potent newer steroids, that is difluprednate and loteprednol, could replace the conventional more potent steroid prednisolone with similar clinical effect and no increased morbidity. Inclusion criteria, age more than 40 years, patients willing to participate in the study, patients with immature senile cataract. After an uncomplicated cataract surgery by phacoemulsification with foldable IOL, the ocular pain, intraocular pressure, anterior chamber inflammation, that is aqueous cells and flare, macular thickness and visual acuity are seen. The observations were made on post-op days 1, 7, 14 and 28. The patients were divided into three groups, 14 each. Group A started on prednisolone for 6 times a day, group B and C for by difluprednate and loteprednol both 4 times a day. All were gradually tapered over 4 weeks. For the ANOVA test and chi-square test were used for statistical analysis, and IBM SPSS version 22 software was used. Results and discussion. Our analysis revealed that the patients distributed across the three groups were comparable in terms of age and sex, thereby making the results of this study applicable to all the cases of uncomplicated cataract we encounter in the clinical practice. This is a cluster bar chart of ocular pain on day one. You can see that in all the three drugs, it is almost the same. And this is a stark bar chart of ocular pain on day 7. Cluster bar chart of comparison of aqueous cells on day 1. This is on day 7. And flare on day 1 and day 7. So actually, after... Okay, sir. So when we compile all these parameters, the p-value was not significant. On comparing the macular thickness and IOP and also visual acuity on all the post-operative days, the p-value was not significant. So while comparing, we took the prednisolone acetate as a baseline and compared the mean difference between difluprednate and loteprednol, the p-value was not significant. So concluding, all the three drugs were comparable in terms of ocular pain, IOP, anterior chamber activity, macular thickness, and visual acuity. In view of less frequent dosing, better patient compliance, reduced topical steroid exposure combined with similar anti-inflammatory effect, clinically, when compared with prednisolone, it is concluded that soft steroids, that is loteprednol and difluprednol, can be used safely in the post-operative regimen of uncomplicated cataract surgery in patients with no significant history of systemic illness. Thank you. These are my references.
Thank you, Dr. Geeta. That was a wonderful presentation. I just have to make a remark that when you do this study in uncomplicated cataract surgery, we don't expect anything. This is what we expect, because there are several studies in which they don't use even steroids post-operatively, they use only NSAIDs. So in an uncomplicated phacoemulsification, when you compare these soft steroids with the prednisolone acetate, I mean, there cannot be much of a difference. So I think that way, I think it is what we are expecting even before you started the study. That is what I would say. I think you can ask madam, because there are again studies in where you can just give one dose of antibiotic with steroids into the lenticular space. And that's what they do. They don't put any steroids post-operatively. So this is these are all studies which have been done. So comparing a soft steroid with a pred foot in this particular situation where it's an uncomplicated cataract surgery, so we don't expect the any difference at all. I would like Dr. Vasantha's comments as well.
And the thing is, we use mostly dexamethasone because pred foot itself, it causes irritation and the patient feels more uncomfortable rather than comfortable.
Yes,
that problem is there. And as Sujata said, there are so many studies in this context saying that the steroids are not that much useful and all that. I would have felt better if you had studied the healing effect, whether the healing is better with the lesser amount of steroids or something like that, something newer, no? Or the incidence of...
You could have compared with an NSAID, just only NSAID alone and steroids.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, in our setup, we use only prednisolone, ma'am. Like, I'm...
Okay.
So, we thought of doing a study with the other soft steroids.
Yeah.
So,
good.
Yes,
I must confess, even though this suggestion has been there for a long time, I still use steroids. I have reduced the number of days, but I don't know. What do you do, Sujata?
We use pred foot, ma'am. Pred foot is a standard protocol. And like you said, we used to use Alcon Pred, which didn't have those precipitation. But we don't get them anymore. And we are using only the regular Pred foot, which is available now.
That's what I'm saying. We haven't stopped using steroids even.
No, absolutely not. We can't stop using steroids.
We haven't switched over to low potent also like Lotipred.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Like the dosage of the steroids, like prednisolone, we should give at least 6 to 8 times. But Lotipred and difluprednate can be given just 4 times. So, in
what
that
about
way
the
also,
effect of these drugs on intraocular pressure?
Ma'am, according to my, in our study, there is no much difference, ma'am. Like soft steroids were... according to our study, there's no much difference between the soft steroids and prednisolone, ma'am. But previously,
what
the studies...
I think all the outcomes were very similar when compared to pred foot and the soft steroids. I mean, there's one thing that we can learn is that soft steroids are enough than putting a pred foot. Maybe that's one point we learned from this.
Yes, ma'am.
Or at least we can switch over to soft steroids after 2 weeks.
After the first week.
Yes, ma'am.
So we'll go on to the next paper.
Thank you, ma'am.
So next we have pre-paper 205 by Dr. Rajalakshmi. Dr. Rajalakshmi, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. I'll start sharing.
I didn't get the number.
205, ma'am. Dr. Rajalakshmi.
Sorry, ma'am, give me some time. I'm just looking for the PPT. It's not available in the share screen that I'm making.
Sharmila, how many more to go, Sharmila? How many more papers?
This is the fifth one, ma'am.
How many more?
This is the sixth one.
This is the sixth one, ma'am. Dr. Rajalakshmi's paper is the sixth one. Three more.
We have one talk at 11. So.
Can we have the next speaker if Dr. Rajalakshmi is going to take some time? Can we have FP 226?
Yes, ma'am.
Geeta?
Yes, ma'am. I'll sort it out. Please carry on with the next one. Thank you.
Dr. Geeta?
No, I think she has started it. Huh?
Is Dr. Geeta there? FP 226? Dr. Geeta, you're there, right? Please unmute yourself. She's there, but she's not unmuting. Yeah, Dr. Geeta, is your presentation ready?
Dr. Geeta?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you start your presentation? Okay, either of you, whoever's ready with the presentation, please go on. Dr. Rajalakshmi or Dr. Geeta.
Even if it is presented without the slides, I don't think there's a big problem. Is there anything, Siddhartha?
Yeah, she's starting. Geeta.
Dr. Geeta has started screen sharing. Dr. Geeta's number is FP226.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
FP226, Dr. Geeta. Why am I there on the screen? I request the presenters to be ready with their presentation. If one of the presentations are not working, we might go to the next one. We have three more presenters. Yes, doctor.
Can you open the windows and keep it minimized? The next presenters, please.
Yeah. Dr. Geeta, you can, yeah, please. Yes, yes. You're clear and your screen is visible. Please go on. Yes, please.
Start. Your timing starts already.
Start. Please start. Please share your video as well. Please share, start your video as well. Your video is off. Dr. Geeta, please start your video as well.
Yes, ma'am.
Is there a point for being tech savvy?
Okay, we can start the presentation, Sharmila. It doesn't matter. Okay. Is not there. Sharmila? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Start the presentation. It's okay.
Yeah, please start, Dr. Geeta. Dr. Geeta, there's too much of echo. Can you speak close to your mic?
What's the problem?
I think her screen froze. Yeah. Dr. Geeta, we are not able to hear you. You have unmuted. You're muted yourself. Please unmute yourself. Dr. Geeta, please unmute.
It's unmuted only. Video only is not...
No, ma'am, it's not unmuted. She is muted.
There's a flash now on the mic.
Now you can start.
Yes,
ma'am, shall I presentate through phone?
Yeah, please.
Okay, ma'am, I'll disconnect and I'll come through phone.
Hello,
this is Rajalakshmi, ma'am. Free paper 205. I'm ready now. Can I present, ma'am?
You can start, Rajalakshmi.
Yeah, Dr. Rajalakshmi, please go ahead.
Yes, thank you. Are my slides visible, ma'am?
Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Rajesh, my slides are visible. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Good morning, one and all. I'm Dr. Rajalakshmi from Jyothi Eye Care Center, Puducherry. Today, my paper is about comparing two viscoelastic agents, HPMC, and a combination of chondroitin sulfate and sodium hyaluronate on endothelial cell count post-phacoemulsification. We are aware about two kinds of OVDs. One is a cohesive, which maintains space in anterior chamber, and other is a dispersive, which retain in the endothelium and protects it better. There are some new groups of viscoelastics called viscous dispersive agents, like Discovisc and Oxalon Plus, which combines the properties of cohesives and dispersives. So one such agent, named the Oxalon Plus, is being compared with 2% HPMC in this study in terms of endothelial protective nature. It was a prospective comparative study, including patients with nucleus sclerosis 1 to 3, posterior subcapsular cataract 1 to 4, and specular count more than 2,000 cells per millimeter square. Whereas patients who are anticipated to have a poor endothelial count, like black Brunnison cataract, small rigid pupil, traumatic cataract, were all excluded from the study. And a routine evaluation for cataract surgery was carried out, including the specular microscope done preoperatively. So patients who were included in the study were operated by a single senior operating surgeon by a microphacoemulsification using a limbal incision of 2.2 millimeters, and 50% were randomized into HPMC group and another 50 eyes were operated with Oxalon Plus. What was the outcome? It was just the endothelial cell count measured at the end of 1 month, and the percentage of reduction of cells was calculated and compared between the two groups using student t-test. So this displays the results of the paper. The left side of the table denotes the HPMC group and the right side the chondroitin sulfate with sodium hyaluronate group. As I have highlighted, these are all the percentage of cell loss. So it's clearly found that the percentage of cell loss is higher in the HPMC group than the chondroitin group. It is again easily understandable with this line diagram, the blue line denoting the HPMC and the red line denoting the combination group. And everywhere we find, in all the variables that we compared, we find that the chondroitin hyaluronate combination fares well, and it's well below the level of the HPMC considering the percentage of endothelial cell loss. And clinical significance was obtained in age more than 60 years and in cataract grades 3 and 4. What we understand is, we know that HPMC is a dispersive OVD, whereas Oxalon Plus combines the property of dispersive as well as cohesives. Also, we know that every year there is an endothelial cell attrition of at the rate of 0.5%. Similarly, in diabetes and hypertensives, there is reducing endothelial cell density compared to the non-comorbidity patient. Also, when we do phacoemulsification in higher grades of cataract, we expect an endothelial compromise. So adding all these, when all such patients come to cataract surgery, they're expected to have a reduction in endothelial cell density, and that is where agents like Oxalon Plus comes to the rescue. Actually, there are no previous literature comparing these two specific viscoelastics, but we could find a similar product, namely Discovisc, comparing its efficacy with visco adaptives like Helon 5 and cohesives like Helon. And they are definitely found to be superior to
1 minute more
individual cohesives. And it is also found that it's superior to using two different viscoelastics as in soft shell technique, because it has a faster removal time also. So I conclude that this combination OVD of 4% chondroitin sulfate and 3% sodium hyaluronate is definitely superior and safer to the endothelium, especially for elderly age groups, diabetics, hypertensives, and in dense cataracts, because of its superior retaining power in endothelium. Also, it can be projected that if specular microscopy can be done in all patients preoperatively, it is made compulsory, then we can handle patients even with hard cataracts and poor endothelium and offer them phacoemulsification.
You finished? Not to hear you.
Dr. Rajalakshmi, are you done with your presentation?
We're not able to hear you.
I think that is the concluding slide, ma'am.
Yeah. She has to stop sharing.
And give a good post-operative vision.
Dr. Rajalakshmi, please unmute yourself and start your video.
She's finished her presentation.
His time is over, no? Time is up.
Yes, ma'am. For the question answer session, they need to switch on the video.
Oh, yes. She is
from question answer.
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, we can hear you. Please switch on the video as well, Dr. Rajalakshmi.
Put on your video. Your face. So she's thinking,
is ma'am, I've already switched it on. Can you see it, ma'am?
We can see it. That's yeah.
Okay, Rajalakshmi, it was a good presentation, and I think you've almost covered everything that is there, and you have only reinforced what has been presented in several papers. But it's a very well done study, and kudos to you for the good presentation as well.
Thank you so much.
I have no
questions. We can move on to the next presentation, please.
Hello, ma'am.
226, Geeta, are you ready?
Dr. Ah, yes, ma'am.
Yours is free paper. What is the number? The next
Dr. Rajalakshmi is 205, madam.
Yeah,
the previous presenter.
Yeah.
The current presenter is free paper 226, 226.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes.
I'm Dr. Geeta from Madurai Medical College, and my paper presentation is on an analytical study on excision of pterygium with sutureless and glueless conjunctival autograft. I'm very grateful to my chief author and co-author for giving me this opportunity to present here. Pterygium, it was identified before 3000 years and it was first reported by Sushruta. It is a triangular encroachment of epithelial covered subconjunctival fibrovascular tissue towards the cornea, usually in the palpebral fissure, commonly on the nasal than the temporal side. Higher incidence of pterygium occurs in the eyes exposed to high ultraviolet rays, dryness, heat, dust and wind. So surgical excision remains the principal mode of treatment for pterygium. There are various techniques have been tried, like simple excision, Bass sclera method, transplantation of head of pterygium, mucous membrane or conjunctival graft or flap to cover the Bass sclera, and lamellar keratoplasty. My present study was concentrated on evaluation and analyzing the surgical outcome of extended excision along with sutureless and glueless or conjunctival autograft in effective management of pterygium. So the aim of the study is to analyze the surgical outcome on excision of pterygium with sutureless and glueless conjunctival autograft in pterygium surgery. And it is a prospective observational study done over 60 patients in patients presenting to our outpatient and residing inpatient in the ophthalmology ward of Government Rajaji Hospital, Madurai, satisfying the following inclusion and exclusion criteria. The inclusion criteria were the patients above 20 years of age of either sex with the progressive nasal and temporal pterygium with a defective vision because of astigmatism or encroachment on pupillary area, pterygium crossing the limbus of grade T2 and T3 of TANS classification. And exclusion criteria were those with the anti-segment disorders, eyelid disorders, retinal pathology requiring the surgical intervention, pseudo pterygium, dry eye and other ocular surface disorders, patients who are pregnant, lactating, and previous history of ocular surgery or trauma, and patients who are not likely to be lost for follow-up were excluded from the study. So the procedure involves the patient was well educated about the significance of the surgery and the detailed surgical procedure, and informed written consent were received, and the patient underwent the excision of pterygium, and it is followed by sutureless and glueless conjunctival autograft using the serum from the bleeding conjunctival vessels for fixation. The preoperative evaluation done were according to the standards. That is, we require an essential ocular history, uncorrected and best corrected visual acuity, slit lamp examination that includes the complete anti-segment evaluation, scioscopy and examination of the retina. So the observation where we compare the preoperative and postoperative visual acuity in patients. So the preoperatively, the patient with the visual acuity of 6-6 were only one patient among 60 patients, whereas in postoperatively, 11 patients have got visual acuity of 6-6. Whereas the preoperative visual acuity of 660 is 9 members, whereas so that this study conclude that the table showed that there was a significant improvement in vision after pterygium excision. Whereas we compared preoperative and postoperative astigmatism, there was a significant reduction in astigmatism after pterygium excision. So the results were best corrected visual acuity has been improved and amount of astigmatism is greatly reduced. So the advantage of the procedure where it has a lower rate of recurrence with the lower incidence of complication, with the good patient comfort, excellent cosmesis, and it is a cost effective. And suture and fibrin related complications were eliminated. The disadvantage is when compared to other procedure, it requires patching for about 48 hours. So to conclude, this study concludes that the pterygium excision induces the reversal of the pterygium induced corneal flattening, resulting in decrease in the postoperative refractive astigmatism and significant improvement in astral acuity. In addition to that, with the sutureless and glueless surgery, it provides added benefit of better comfort and cosmesis. Thank you.
Time over.
Thank you, Dr. Geeta. That was again a very good, excellent presentation. And this is not a comparative study. You didn't do any comparison with other methods of pterygium. It's just a...
No, ma'am. It's just an analysis.
So you didn't have any patients who had a graft dislodgement and all that. Did you have any patients?
Ma'am, one patient had yes, ma'am. I have one patient with a graft dislodgement and a postoperative day 10, ma'am.
So what did you do to those patients?
Only one patient.
Okay.
Ma'am, do it again with a fibrin glue, ma'am, actually. He again got the recurrence after 6 months and we proceeded with that.
Okay, that's all.
Study design, is it a prospective observation study or a prospective intervention study? You said it's prospective observation.
It's an intervention.
Study design.
Ma'am, we observe the results, ma'am, but the...
You said that you use the serum of the conjunctival blood leaking blood. How did you get the serum? You just leave it up there, no?
It's only the fibrin clot which helps in adhesion between the graft and the conjunctiva, ma'am.
Then you're not obtaining the fibrin or the serum or anything. You leave the blood which is leaking from the conjunctiva and leave it there.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. It's only the fibrin clot.
Okay. Now, what we did is, Sharmila was there in the unit at that time, I think. We just put a drop of the patient's own blood and then saw, isn't it? There was a necrosis of the sclera in two patients. You remember, Sharmila? I think you were there.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, I have seen one case, ma'am.
Have you seen anything like that? Any problem in the sclera?
No, ma'am.
And sometimes you see
a hematoma. In our patients, we didn't observe.
You didn't notice any
hemorrhage. We had post-operative subconjunctival hemorrhage patient.
Only problem
two
is
patients got SCH, but there is no necrosis.
The problem is that, you know, if it doesn't stick well, then the graft can dislodge or it can become edematous or it can, like ma'am said, it can melt. So, I mean, I prefer to use a glue. Of course, there are some people who will still use sutures. Can we move on to the next, Dr. Vasantha?
Okay.
Next, we have Dr. Niveta, will be presenting her paper of FP285 on intracameral moxifloxacin limiting endophthalmitis.
அவங்க கேட்டதே அந்த சீரம் வந்து ஏன் யூஸ் பண்றீங்க ஸ்டடியா இருந்தா நான் என்ன பண்றது சீரம் யூஸ் பண்றது.
Is my slide visible, ma'am?
Yeah, your slide is visible. I request the other participants to mute yourself. Dr. Geeta, please mute yourself.
She doesn't know that she has been hurt and she didn't understand my question also.
Can I start,
there is
ma'am?
A webinar. Yes, Dr. Niveta, please.
Good morning, one and all gathered here. I'm Dr. Niveta from Regional Institute of Ophthalmology, Egmore. I'm here to present on a topic of safety and efficacy of intracameral moxifloxacin in preventing post-cataract surgery endophthalmitis. Endophthalmitis after cataract surgery is a serious and potentially vision-threatening complication, especially when there is a posterior capsular rupture. Antibiotic penetration into the anterior chamber after topical drugs is relatively low when compared to intracameral doses. The available intracameral antibiotics are cefiroxime, vancomycin, and moxifloxacin. The aim of the study was to evaluate the safety and efficacy of intracameral moxifloxacin in preventing post-cataract surgery endophthalmitis. It is a prospective intervention study conducted in a tertiary eye care center in Chennai. Duration of the study was 6 months and 300 eyes were included. Patients diagnosed with cataract and for whom surgery is indicated was evaluated and taken up for the study after getting consent. Age of 30 to 70 years and a visually significant cataract with endothelial cell count more than 2000 were included. Patients with fluoroquinolone allergy and cataract surgery associated with other surgeries and a history of previous corneal surgery and advanced glaucoma were excluded. A detailed preoperative evaluation was done, a best corrected visual acuity, slit lamp and fundus examination. Intraocular pressure and corneal endothelial cell density were measured. Majority of the people, patients were of the age group of 50 to 60 years. We had a female preponderance and the surgery was either manual SACS or a phacoemulsification with 52% were SACS and 48 were phacoemulsification. The mean preoperative IOP was 40 millimeters of mercury and a mean corneal endothelial cell density was 2,551 cells. Intraoperatively, a peribulbar anesthesia, skin sterilization is very important with a 10% povidone-iodine. 5% povidone-iodine was administered in the cul-de-sac for 3 minutes with subsequent irrigation. A sterile drape was applied, SACS or phacoemulsification by a single surgeon. Intracameral moxifloxacin 0.5 milligram in 0.1 ml was administered at the end of the surgery. A topical 0.5% moxifloxacin was administered and a pattern manager was applied. Postoperatively, all the patients received moxifloxacin with prednisolone acetate eye drops, which was gradually tapered. The patients were followed up for 6 weeks. Slit lamp examination and visual acuity was documented on all visits. The best corrected visual acuity, intraocular pressure and corneal endothelial cell density was recorded on the 45th postoperative day. The main outcomes of the study was the incidence of acute postoperative endophthalmitis and corneal endothelial cell density, the corrected distal visual acuity and the mean intraocular pressure. The variables were compared with pair t-test and statistical significance was set as 0.05. The results said there was no incidence of endophthalmitis during the follow-up period. Slit lamp examination and fundus examination was uneventful. There was no change in the significant change in the intraocular pressure postoperatively, with the mean IOP was for 14 millimeters of mercury. The mean postoperative endothelial cell density was 2004. The endothelial cell density loss was 145. 93% of the patients had a best corrected visual acuity more than 612. Moxifloxacin is a self-preserved solution. There was no special preparation was required. There is a reduced risk of TAS. There has been many studies previously conducted that showed a fourfold reduction in the postoperative endophthalmitis and no intraocular toxicity. To conclude, the study showed that intracameral injection of 0.1 ml of 0.5% moxifloxacin is safe and efficient. It is easily available. It's a self-preserved solution. It can be readily used as an intracameral injection. It can be used as a routine surgical practice, especially in cases of posterior capsular rupture. However, a large sample size controlled randomized clinical trial is recommended to prove the hypothesis. These are my references. Thank you.
Already there are so many studies saying that moxifloxacin is really necessary, but I don't use moxifloxacin intracameral. So far, I have not used it at all. Okay, so I'm not for. So you may use it, but that is how many? See this, so many years. Sharmila, we have not used intraocular moxifloxacin in our hospital. I mean, your hospital, perhaps you should say, your hospital now.
Ma'am, I can just make a small comment on that. When we were doing ECCs and SICS and all that, the chance of the low-grade endophthalmitis was very less.
No, I'm not talking about...
No reason for, I mean, whereas once the phacoemulsification started, the chance of low-grade endophthalmitis, and because it's a closed chamber, that was the reason why the intracameral antibiotics were introduced. And we are using...
One second, Sujata, I am talking about phacoem, not ECCS.
So there are several studies which have proven that the need for intracameral antibiotics has definitely reduced the incidence of endophthalmitis. We routinely use moxifloxacin postoperatively immediately after the surgery is over. So the maximum MIC is achieved on the table, so that the chances of endophthalmitis is reduced. Of course, there are a lot of surgeons like Dr. Vasanta who don't use them. But I think the studies have proven that definitely it has a value, and particularly in large volume centers like Madurai, GOH, mm-hmm. and all those people, I think it really makes a lot of difference. Thank you. Can we move on to the next paper if ma'am is not... Okay.
Last paper for today will be by Dr. Shobha, paper number FP23.
23,
yeah? 23.
That's the final presentation.
Oh, that's all,
yeah? Yes, ma'am. We're almost, we started a little late, so we are on time.
No, there is, it says page 10 of 11, so one more to go. This is the 10th page, so one more to go.
No, I saw only 9 papers.
9 papers only, ma'am.
Only 9.
Okay.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yes, start, doctor.
Yes, ma'am, I'll share my...
Your first slide is there.
The video... Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Shobha from Joseph Eye Hospital, Trichy. Today, my presentation is entitled Tear Film Parameters in Unilateral Pterygium. Pterygium is an elevated superficial fibrovascular mass starting at the perilimbal conjunctiva and extending over to the cornea as the disease progresses. Pathologically, it represents a subconjunctival elastotic degeneration. Of the various tear film tests, Schirmer's test without anesthesia detects problems in aqueous layer stability, and tear breakup time detects mucin and lipid layer stability of the tear film. There is a proposed dual relationship between pterygium and dry eye, where one promotes formation of the other. The aim of the study was to compare the tear film status in eyes with unilateral pterygium using the fellow eye as a control so that the fellow eye shares the same genetic background and environmental factors as the other cases. It was a prospective observational study. Eyes with unilateral pterygium were included. Eyes with inflamed pterygiums, other corneal conjunctival lid pathologies, that are eyes that had undergone ocular surgeries, contact lens users, and other ocular or systemic causes of dry eyes were excluded from the study. 50 eyes with pterygium were compared with 50 fellow eyes without pterygium. Following a detailed anterior segment evaluation and a relevant posterior segment evaluation, Schirmer's test 1 was done, and values less than 10 millimeters was considered abnormal. Following that, a tear film breakup time was done, and values less than 10 seconds were considered as an unstable tear film. The first picture is showing a Schirmer's 1 test in progress. Second picture is showing a tear film breakup time, where the appearance of a first dry spot. This study had 38% of females and 62% males. The slide shows Schirmer's 1 test results, where 6% of eyes with pterygium and 2% of eyes without pterygium had values less than 10 millimeters. This is the tear film breakup time test results, where 36% of eyes with pterygium and 32% of eyes without pterygium had values less than 10 seconds. Comparing the mean values of Schirmer's 1 and TBUT tests, it was seen that eyes with pterygium had significantly lower Schirmer's 1 as well as TBUT values. Discussion: the Schirmer's test value ranged from about 4 to 435 millimeters in eyes with pterygium and 12 to 35 millimeters at the end of 5 minutes in the control group. The statistically lower mean Schirmer's 1 test values at the end of 5 minutes in pterygium eyes suggests that possible pterygium induced aqueous layer instability. The statistically lower mean TBUT values in the pterygium group compared to the control group suggests possibility of mucin and lipid layer instability in pterygium. This could be explained by various factors, some of which are normal blinking may be compromised in eyes with pterygium, leading to desiccated epithelium affecting surface tension and tear film stability in pterygium eyes. There's also been a possible relationship between meibomian gland dysfunction and pterygium that has been suggested. Ozutsu et al. Found that eyes with pterygium had higher tear osmolarity, lower levels of TBUTs, and Schirmer's test compared to the healthy fellow eyes. Wu et al. And E et al. Explained a possible association between meibomian gland dysfunction and overlying pterygiums. Pterygium causes a local inflammation and release of cytokines, which can possibly lead to meibomian gland dysfunction. Safarzada et al. Found that pterygiums produce changes in various factors like tear secretion, increased evaporation, deterioration of epithelial cells and goblet cells, and also elevated tear osmolarity. The limitations in this study were inability to perform other tear film parameters such as mean goblet cell density, tear osmolarity, and conjunctival impression cytologies. Also, measurement of the pterygium dimensions would have given us more information about the effect of pterygium in dry eyes. In conclusion, pterygium-affected eyes had significantly lower tear film parameters such as Schirmer's test 1 and TBUTs than the normal fellow eyes in this study. This can be attributed to increased evaporation of tears following ocular surface changes, as well as a possible meibomian gland dysfunction secondary to pterygium, thus affecting tear film stability. These are my references. Thank you.
Excellent presentation, Shobha.
Thank you.
Really very well done. I just have 2 points. One, you've already mentioned, you know, doing a tear film osmolarity or additional tests like, even this inflammatory test, you know, to rule out cytokines, MMP9. Those tests which you have missed out will definitely give us more information. Yes, the second thing I was thinking of is, as a follow-on to this study, if you do a tear film study in patients who have undergone pterygium surgery,
yes,
undergone after the pterygium with conjunctival autograft, whether the tear film stability is improving, then yes, that will be also a very good comparative study. Your study is really good. There are a lot of papers which have shown that even pterygium, the tear film instability could be an inciting factor for MGD, and then it becomes like a vicious cycle. So yes, but it's a very well done study.
Thank you.
Any comments?
Oh, that's a good idea. If you give tear films, tear substitutes, without even studying this, they have been giving.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a nice study.
Yes.
Thank you.
We come to the end of this free paper session, and kudos to the organizing team and especially to Dr. Atik for bringing this thing together. And I think it's a great effort because it's the first time we are going online and your paper is being presented this way. Congratulations, Dr. Atik and team. And the results will be announced around 3 o'clock. A YouTube link will be posted. Kindly follow that link to all participants.
Yeah, just can I make one comment?
Yes, madam.
This is for the presenters. So what yes, I ma'am. Find is whenever we go for judging a free paper session, the first 70% of their slides contains only introduction. Yes. And discussion and results are discussed in 2 or 3 slides. See, all the judges know about the what is keratoconus or what is the condition. So they should just do the reverse. Just keep a little 1 or 2 slides as introduction. And then you start your study. Your study should start from the 3rd or 4th slide. Instead, almost all of them, you know, they just have very few minutes to just 1 minute to discuss the results. So basically, they are not able to work on how to express it and how to make it more meaningful, and also more to emphasize on their study. That is very important. This is just, I've been wanting to tell this in several meetings, but I thought I'll just share it here.
Thank you, madam. So I said you're a great teacher.
Thank you, Dr. Atik and everyone else for the wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
One second. I'm not able to, when I tried the Google Forms, it is saying it is not available.
It's, I finished, ma'am. I submitted, ma'am.
And then she'll post it.
Madam, we'll help you do it, madam.
I finished it. I finished submitting, Divya.
Okay. Now,
I have to leave for another talk. So please excuse me. Thank you.
Thank you very much,
Dr.
Madam and Dr. Sujata Madam.
Thank you.
Dr. Sharmila and Dr. Divya for valid points and sharing and judging the session and the papers.
Thank you, madam.
Thank the presenters. And I thank the coordinator, Debalina, for this session. Thank you very much, one and all.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Devia and Sharmila. Thank you so much. Thanks, Manoj, sir. Thank you.
Doctor, we are closing this session now.